Now we're going to be turning our attention to Jane Austen. The first thing I need to say is that we're talking about Austen after the Romantics, but that's in many ways inappropriate because Jane Austen is really the culmination of the 18th century novel, much more than a development of the Romantic period. And other than writing during the same time as Wordsworth and Coleridge, she has little in common with their political or their social philosophies or with their literary practices. She's much more indebted to the writers of the 18th century who preceded her. So rather than a romantic author, Jane Austen is most productively seen as a conclusion of the 18th century novel tradition and a transition between the 18th and the 19th century novel. So it's useful to look at her in terms of her previous influences, and Jane Austen was heavily influenced by writers that came before her. In the first place, we can see in her writing tone and her methods the influence of 18th century Augustan urbane literate culture. This culture developed at the beginnings of the 18th century with the writings of Joseph Addison and Richard Steele, who developed the Tatler and then later the Spectator, fairly short-lived but very influential early journals, which cultivated this sort of knowing, witty voice, commenting upon society and literature in a intelligent, perceptive, literate way. And this is a tradition carried on to some extent by Samuel Johnson, the famous dictionary writer of the 18th century and mid-century with The Rambler. Her literary roots not only include the general literary tone of the period, but also come from the previous novelists and reflect in many ways the tone that they cultivated in their novels. Lawrence Stern, for example, in his somewhat quirky novel, The Life and Opinions of Tristram Shandy Gentleman, shows that it's already possible to make fun of the tradition of the novel, even at its very origins, because he is writing a novel that is supposed to be about the life and opinions of Tristram Shandy, and yet Tristram Shandy isn't actually born until the middle of the novel, and the novel itself is made up of a significant number of digressions that transition away from the main plot line. Another influence is Henry Fielding. Henry Fielding not only in the tone, but also in the relationship between the narrator and her narrative. In Tom Jones, the narrator will introduce each chapter with a brief description of the narrator himself and what he's doing and what he thinks. And then Joseph Andrews is an outgrowth of Henry Fielding's parody of Samuel Richardson's novel Pamela. And then, of course, there's Samuel Richardson himself. Samuel Richardson was perhaps the most influential author when we're talking about Jane Austen, because she is an admitted fan and even mentions Sir Charles Grandison in Northanger Abbey directly and mentions it in a positive light. Samuel Richardson's novels influenced Jane Austen in a couple of ways. In the first place, Richardson began his novel career writing what was intended to be a conduct book for young ladies. And Pamela originated that way. It was originally supposed to be an epistolary novel. An epistolary novel is a novel made up of letters written by a variety of characters. In this case, most of them are by Pamela, but others write letters as well. And the origin of Pamela was that it was going to be a conduct book in which Pamela's virtue is rewarded. And Pamela is a young woman who goes to work in the household of Mr. B, and Mr. B designs to corrupt her virtue and, in fact, imprisons her on a remote estate where the housekeeper conspires with Mr. B to corrupt Pamela. And she manages, through a very long novel of 1,000 pages and hundreds of letters, to continually fight off Mr. B until finally, convincing him of the truth of her virtue, she converts him and he marries her. Clarissa is to some extent the negative image of this novel. Clarissa is also a young woman of virtue. virtue. However, she becomes subject to the vicious plots of a young rake who imprisons her, ultimately attempting to steal her virtue, and finally succeeds, at which point Clarissa dies and the young man ends up suffering tremendous remorse and a degraded life. And then finally, the history of Sir Charles Grandison is the novel mentioned in Northanger Abbey, in which the main character, Sir Charles Grandison himself, goes around helping other people who need his character and virtue. The other major influence on Jane Austen is obviously the Gothic novel. Gothic novels have two major kinds of narrative tracks. The first kind of narrative track is a story of supernatural occurrences and the mysterious, of paintings that bleed and ghosts that walk. There's a subvariant of this kind of novel which is similar to Scooby-Doo kinds of stories, where ultimately the mysteries are revealed to be the machinations of some sinister villain. And the other kind of Gothic novel is the one in which some evil villain kidnaps a young woman against her will and takes her off to be either married to his sickly son for his nefarious purposes, or he wants to seduce and marry her himself. Now, most of the novels published in this tract during this period, and there are many, there are literally hundreds of Gothic novels, are truly silly trash. They deserve the accusation of Wordsworth in his preface that they're sickly and stupid German tragedies and frantic novels. But there are some that have a certain amount of literary quality and survived. Anne Radcliffe's novel, The Mysteries of Udolpho, which is the one most prominently featured in Northanger Abbey, is certainly one of these, as is Horace Walpole's The Castle of Otranto. Horace Walpole had a side gig to being a Gothic novelist, of being the Prime Minister of England. And then, of course, not mentioned in Northanger Abbey is Matthew Lewis's The Monk, although we have a selection of it in the Norton Anthology, which you've read. So these are the other set of influences that Jane Austen is self-consciously parodizing in her novel. Jane Austen is writing during the Regency period, the period during which England was ruled by the Prince Regent because the actual King, George III, was mentally incapable of ruling the kingdom. Now, Jane Austen has been accused of being an apolitical writer, of writing primarily family dramas and romance stories. But this is far from true in two senses. The first sense is, of course, the one in which everything is political, politics being the relationship between people in a society. And so even families contain politics. But there's another sense in which the novels are inscribed with a political structure as well. England at this point in time is going through a massive social change. It's a period of unprecedented social mobility as industrial society is creating new sources of wealth. Traditionally, English aristocracy gained its wealth through the ownership of land and inherited wealth from family lines. So land was really wealth in feudal society. One derived one's wealth from land holdings. But in industrial society, wealth is created through new means, through industrial production. And people who did not necessarily have access to large amounts of land could have access to massive industrial production and could be capable of gaining a tremendous amount of wealth. And so what's happening at this particular time is that many people who in the past would have been confined to a mercantile or lower class role are now finding new ways to make wealth and to establish themselves within the English hierarchy. And in fact, many of these people are becoming embedded into the aristocracy as they either created a false heritage. There were a group of people who were involved in the College of Heraldry, whose job was to research her ancestry and to locate some ancestor who had some claim, dubious or not, to an aristocratic background. And in other cases, they simply bought titles. They made arrangements where they could exchange money for a title, usually by buying an estate and then making an arrangement to have the title that was associated with that estate attached to their family. Many of the characters in Jane Austen's novels, we find out, are people who are nouveau riche, who were not born to the manor, and rather have gained their wealth recently Some of them are admirals or generals who gained their wealth through the spoils of war. Others are people who married into the aristocracy. And one example of that is Lady Catherine de Bourgh in Pride and Prejudice, who positions herself as a woman of culture. But in fact, there are many hints throughout the novel that she doesn't actually have any culture. She can't play. She says, "I would have been a great proficient had I learned." She can't draw. And in fact, she's the daughter of a tradesman who married into wealth and then is determined to keep other people from her same advantage. So there is a tremendous amount of social mobility. And Jane Austen's characters tend to be situated exactly in the part of society where this social mobility would take place. They're at the very bottom of the aristocracy or the very top of the middle classes. And they inhabit this liminal realm between the aristocratic state and the middle class state. So they're knights. Knights' titles are not inherited. They have to be conferred. Or they're baronets, which is the very bottom of the aristocracy. And so these people are people in this sort of fluid state, and the characters in the novels are having to navigate the complexities of this fluid state. For example, in Pride and Prejudice, Elizabeth Bennet's family is a family at the bottom of the aristocracy. They're wealthy, they own land, they're well established, but the home that they own is entailed. An entail is a special provision in a will which says to whom the state will devolve should there not be male progeny to that family. And in the Bennet family, they have no sons. And so the family is going to go to Mr. Collins, who is a cousin, because he's the next person in line for the inheritance. So the difficulty of navigating this society is that you have to find out a way where the traditional aristocracy, which is now being more or less invaded by newcomers, by nouveau riche, can deal with those complications. And this is the problem that Elizabeth Bennet faces, because her love interest in the novel, sorry if I'm spoiling anything, Mr. Darcy, is in fact an aristocrat. And they actually have a significant social barrier to their marriage, which is that they come from different social classes, which would have been widely discouraged in traditional aristocratic England. But they have to find a way to make a relationship work within those circumstances. This is a similar situation to Catherine Morland's. Catherine Morland is from the family of a gentleman. Her father is a minister, and so he's well educated and he has a sufficient income in order to project an era of gentility, and in order to send his daughter off to Bath nominally to find a husband, because that's basically why one would go to a watering hole like Bath during the season. And she is of age to at least meet a prospective husband. But on the other hand, she's not either extraordinarily wealthy, nor is she someone who has a title that she can trade. And so her prospects at this particular point are not great. She has to find a husband, but she has to find someone who's willing to compromise on the amount of wealth that they will accept from a spouse or the title they can confer. And it's very often that people from the title class, from the aristocracy, would go off and marry someone who may not have a title but had a lot of money, and they would be mutually beneficial. The person with the title would gain money to support their estate, and the person with the money would gain a title to support their social class. That was not at all uncommon. And so Bath is essentially a marriage market where people are bringing their daughters to market them either so that they can gain wealth or gain a title. And Catherine Morland is settling into this marriage market. And the story revolves around Catherine is unable to recognize the social intrigue that's going on around her because she's so caught up in the fictional intrigue that she has adopted from the Gothic novel. She's deluded by the Gothic novel and blinded to the actual problems that surround her. And we'll see how, in Jane Austen's very comical way, Catherine is blinded by her Gothic narrative that she's trying to impose on society from seeing the actual intrigue in which she is involved and which threatens her in a very significant way, and which she ultimately becomes a victim to, though not in any way the way she imagined she would be. Now, Jane Austen's heroines tend to inhabit one of two classes. Either they are ingenues, they are innocents who come through the progress of the novel to recognize their true social situation and their relationship to the people around them. One thinks of Emma. Or they are preternaturally wise, recognizing the situation around them and thereby educating the others around them into what they have already recognized. In this case, one thinks of Fanny Price in Mansfield Park. Now, Catherine Morland is a little of both. She is, as I said before, blinded to her social situation. She is truly an ingenue. But part of her appeal to people around her, people like Henry and Eleanor Tilney, is that she is innocent and unpretentious and honest. So on the one hand, her state as an ingenue, as an innocent, blinds her to the circumstances with which she's involved, to humorous, although potentially tragic, results if she doesn't recognize them in time. But on the other hand, her innocence serves as a foil to expose the craven intrigues of people like Isabella Thorpe and Captain Tilney, for that matter. In order to appreciate Jane Austen's novel and Catherine's circumstance, one needs to appreciate the ironic tone adopted by the narrator. Irony refers to, in its most general sense, maintaining multiple levels of meaning simultaneously. Jane Austen's novel uses irony heavily. It is really more than just a trope. It's really a super trope because it forms a structural element in many, if not all, narratives. And we'll see irony used heavily by poets such as Robert Browning in his dramatic monologues later. Irony comes in a variety of flavors. The most common and probably the most well-known kind of irony is verbal irony, a subcategory of which is sarcasm. Verbal irony is when one says something, but the way one says it implies an opposite or different meaning from what the words seem to mean. And that's where sarcasm comes from. Sarcasm comes from a Latin term that means the tearing of flesh. Sarcasm is irony with intent to injure. If I were to look at someone and say something like, "Wow, that was a smart thing to say," it's very clear that what I meant is actually the opposite, and that would be a form of sarcasm. The next kind of irony is situational irony. Situational irony is what most people think of when they refer to ironic things. Situational irony is when what actually occurs is different from what has been led to expect. So one has been led to expect one outcome and some different outcome occurs. Situational irony figures very heavily in this novel, both in terms of what happens to the characters, but also in terms of what the novelist is doing to us. Dramatic irony is the kind of irony when the audience is given information that the characters do not know, or when the audience is able to surmise circumstances that the characters haven't figured out. It's very common in detective fiction when we know who the villain is, but the detective doesn't. And the detective's task in the narrative is to come to understand what we already know. It also is common in movies with dramatic suspense. Horror movies in which we know the young spring breakers shouldn't go make out in a cabin inhabited by the hockey masked wearing knife wielding lunatic, for example. Then there's romantic irony. Romantic irony is a literary form of breaking the fourth wall in movies. It's when the narrator or a character indicates they know they're in a fiction. In a movie, it might be where the character turns around and looks into the camera. Of course, the character is not supposed to know that the camera or the audience is there. In this case, it might be something where the narrator actually stops the narrative to talk about the narrative, betraying that they know they're writing a fictional story rather than giving us a true history. And Jane Austen's narrator actually does that when she talks about her character, her protagonist, who is not the traditional Gothic heroine. Structural irony is a kind of irony where it makes up the structure of the narrative as a whole. A romana clef, or novel with a key, is a novel where the names have been changed to protect the innocent, but we know who they really are. An allegory is a kind of narrative
which tells a tale which is internally coherent, but also refers to something outside of itself, like Pilgrim's Progress, in which a character named Christian tries to head for the celestial city. And we know that this character Christian represents Christian people, and the celestial city represents heaven. And so it both has internal reference, but also external reference. And then finally, Cosmic Irony is a narrative in which the cosmos or the universe as a whole seems to have it out for a main character, or continually frustrates expectations of the main character. This novel actually has a sense of cosmic irony in that Catherine Morland occupies what she thinks is the Gothic universe, and the universe itself continually frustrates her expectations of Gothic events, nevertheless putting her into events which she did not understand or anticipate.
Austin's narrator is brilliantly ironic, maintaining multiple kinds of irony throughout the text. She uses romantic irony when she stops and talks about herself as a novelist and her characters as the characters in a novel. And also there's implicit romantic irony when she continually makes reference to the Gothic expectations with which Catherine frustrates. She also uses verbal irony, representing Catherine's expectations of what her life should be as a normal life, in terms of Gothic expectations, and how extraordinary it is that Catherine is actually a normal girl in a normal life with normal parents to whom normal things happen, despite the fact that it seems so extraordinary she doesn't have to suffer through all of the travails of a Gothic heroine. There's also verbal irony, where the narrator is describing her characters. Her descriptions of Mrs. Allen, for instance, are brilliantly mean, tearing down her character in a funny way. So we need to watch those different kinds of irony. But the most important irony to pay attention to in this novel is the structural irony. The fact that we have been led to expect, as Catherine has been led to expect, one kind of threat to her safety, that she will be abducted by a sinister villain who is going to spirit her away to a castle where either he will ravage her, or he will force her to marry his sickly son, or he will force her to marry he himself while he tortures his other victims in dungeons within the castle. And this is the life that Catherine perversely expects. But this life blinds her to what actually happens in the novel, which is the realistic alternative version of the fate that Catherine fears. And so we want to pay attention to the structural irony. The narrator is building us up as she builds Catherine up for disappointment, because she will not face the kind of dramatic crisis that she anticipates. But in fact, she does face a dramatic crisis of an entirely different and much more realistic nature. In the novel, Catherine expects to be abducted by a sinister villain who will force her away to a romantic Gothic castle, or in this case, an abbey, and imprison her while he forces her to either marry he himself or his sickly son. But what actually happens in the novel is something surprisingly similar. Catherine, unaware of the threat that she faces, is abducted, taken away by the novel's villain, General Tilney, where he anticipates that he will be able to trick her into marrying his son so that he will be able to gain control of her wealth. While Catherine is trying to find the romantic life of a Gothic heroine, she's very much in danger of falling into the trap faced by a real young woman of Regency England of her time.